morning. My name is Tomasz Stępień and I'm the president of the Firearms United, which is a pan-European organization protecting the civil liberties and the right to arms. This is our first time on this conference and we're very glad to be here. Together with me is a board member from the Firearms United, Maximilian. Please show yourself up. And I'm just asking you to do so for one reason, because we keep hearing that you have problems with powers or the state legislature of the state of California. So if you are looking for a change of the leadership, Maximilian is Austrian. okay, the subject of my today's speech is European Union Directive 91/477/EEC, aka the directive for us, which basically surfaced or showed up on our radar screens at the end of 2015 after the horrible attacks, terrorist attacks in Paris. With some, pardon my French, obscene logics applied by the unelected bureaucrats from Brussels, which is our counterpart to your federal government. They decided that when people die because of the terrorist acts, they want to punish the law-abiding citizens and the legal gun owners with no factual evidence of any connection between the two groups. The only stretched connection between the facts was that in the attack at Charlie Hebdo newspaper, one of the guns has been bought in Slovakia in memory serves as a deactivated movie prop and illegally reconverted to a useful state, which doesn't change the fact that it has nothing to do whatsoever with illegal gun ownership. That was the only connection they tried to explore. The plan from the Brussels was to actually have this directive implemented within 6 months. It seemed overly ambitious. What they did was that they've actually woken up many of people who were not so willing to go after their rights beforehand. So the people started to organize, and our organization was a deputy of this fight against the European Commission. To make the long story short, instead of a 6 months, the European Commission wanted to have to deal with this situation, it took them a year and a half to actually vote this directive in as the law, which they did. However, in a very different form and format than they hoped for. Yes, we do have a legislation right now which says that no rifle which is shorter than 60 centimeters can be legally owned by a private person, or we have a ban or a limitation on the high capacity magazines, whatever the hell that is. It's just a magazine for me, but okay. With the provisions which are actually protecting the people who possess them right now, we do have certain limitations on the possession of rifles, which are ex-military in the sense that they used to be a full auto rifles and has been converted into semi-automatic firing, which also no longer are allowed in the general public in Europe. But just to give you a sample of why do we think that our work was successful, the initial opening position by the European Commission was total ban on any rifles with mechanism visually resembling full auto rifles. I don't know how more scientific can you get with a visual resemblance. It doesn't bother the bureaucrats sitting everywhere. So from this perspective, we reached out to many organizations in the US and we started to compare notes, because basically the argumentations which are being used in Europe and in the US are awfully similar. And during the many conversations I had with colleagues on this side of the Atlantic Ocean, Two names are being propped up as a masterminds behind this. One has been mentioned several times today already, Mr. Bloomberg. The other one is Mr. Soros. We are fortunate that, well, in a sense, that we only have Mr. Soros on our side of the Atlantic Ocean, but he is enough to make our life hard.
Yeah.
Also because he funds the institutes which are basically publishing the falsified data, like a small arms survey from Geneva, which is his personal outfit producing false statistics on the gun usage. And they are not hiding this anymore. So that is what the Brussels government is trying to do to the countries. We are right now in a moment in which each individual member state within the European Union has 15 months or 10 months left to actually adjust the local regulations to the laws coming out from the directive. And we are spending a lot of time on the country level with local governments, it's like your state governments, to work with them. And some of them are willing to work with us to actually dilute this directive as much as possible. The prime example of the proper stance to be taken is the government of the Czech Republic. Because in the directive there is a clause that says that this directive does not apply to the military forces of the country and the reserve force in the countries. So what the Czech Republic government did, they decided that they will change the constitution and they will name each and every gun owner a reservist. Thank you, case closed. Which, from the sources which we have, will be probably followed up by the Slovakia, and the Polish government is toying with the idea as well. So the former communist countries are actually more alive and kicking than the Western Europe. That's pretty much what's going on, as Rick said, and I just wanted to tackle this because once we've been pretty successful in fighting off the directive and we went to work with the local governments, then inevitably the Gunner brothers started to look for another excuse. And by chance, 3 weeks ago, they started to talk about the toxicity levels of the lead ammunition. Surprise, surprise. So this is our next battle, and that's why also we're here to compare the notes. And just to wrap this up and give you the last sentence, we've been successful again as an organization of going to our politicians, making their lives hell if needs be, to the point that Mr. Juncker, which is one of the head honchos of the European Commission, said in one of the interviews during the legislative process that he never ever experienced such an aggressive gun lobby. So he thought that we will take it badly, but I just want to show you our response to this. Yeah, we are the gun lobby, and we're not going anywhere. Thank you.